I'm the lead author on this study, and I wanted to take a moment just to spell out a few things, tell you guys what we did, why we did it, and why I think this study is interesting. So what do we do in this study? Well, we wanted to figure out how we could measure hallucinations. So what is a hallucination? Let's start with that. Hallucinations are a sensory conscious experience that a lot of us actually have in everyday life. An experience where there's no stimulus, there's no thing out in the world. A bit like when we imagine something, but a hallucination is like imagery, but it's automatic. It's involuntary. We don't really have control over it like we do with our imagination. Also, hallucinations are a pretty unsettling and uncomfortable symptom in quite a few different mental and neurological disorders. And unfortunately, we don't have too many options for treatment. So part of what we're trying to do here is develop new ways to study hallucinations, to look at the mechanisms behind them. What causes an hallucination? Where does it come from in the brain? Once we understand these things, we can start to develop and build new treatments for hallucinations. So, where do we start? Can we measure hallucinations? Any kind of hallucination, these kinds of hallucinations, organic hallucinations, perhaps hallucinations in Parkinson's disease, visual hallucinations. One thing we've known for many years, I think over 100 years, is if you flicker, if you flash light at people, they start to hallucinate. Super simple. The problem is they hallucinate all kinds of different things. They hallucinate colors, lines, dots, spinning windmills, all kinds of things. So the scientific question then becomes, how can you measure that? How can you measure this thing that involves all these different shapes, all different colors, and it's constantly changing? So how can we measure that? Well, what people have done is got participants in studies to draw the hallucinations. Get a crayon or a pencil and draw them. And here's some examples of that. You see a cross, you see, you can make out, you see some windmills there, some hexagon patterns, some spirals, some dots, all kinds of things. But we can't do a lot of science with drawings. They're too hard to interpret. They're too subjective. Likewise, when people verbally describe their hallucinations, it's very hard for us to turn that into interesting data that we can graph, look at, and figure out what might be going on in the brain. So here's the problem. How can we develop an objective, reliable, scientific method to measure hallucinations? And could we develop a way to do this in the lab, here at the university, whenever we want? So you think of these flickering lights as a type of an illusion. You flash lights and people hallucinate. And one idea that I'm a big fan of is talking about illusions as being a microscope for the mind. Today we're talking about how we can use an illusion, or hack an illusion, change an illusion, to measure hallucinations. So what we did, rather than flickering just complete white, let's say computer monitor, or lots of flashing lights, we flickered something like this, an annulus, a donut stimulus. We flashed on white, on, off. Super simple. So here's an example. If you don't like flickering things, look away. But this is kind of what the subject saw. Of course, this is not under the same situations. Here's a rendition from someone in the lab showing what they saw. And you can see these light gray blobs appearing here on the annulus. Again, this is a rendition of what they hallucinated and what quite a few different people reported hallucinating. These light gray blobs appearing around the annulus, around the donut. So why is this interesting? Why is this cool? Well, people kept seeing these blobs. They didn't see color. They didn't see lines. They didn't see windmills. They didn't see all the other kinds of different shapes. So all they're seeing is blobs. In other words, what we've done is we've reduced this huge feature space down into just blobs. Once we do that, all of a sudden, these flicker-induced hallucinations become much easier to measure. We don't have an infinite number of different things we have to try and measure. Now we just have these blobs to measure, and perhaps the rotation of the blobs. And we can design experiments to measure blobs, to measure the strength, the speed, all kinds of things. There's lots of techniques out there for doing that. So the most interesting development here is really reducing that feature space from the almost infinite and constantly changing sort of mixed up version of hallucinations, these complex patterns that are very hard to study, and reducing it down, minimizing it to this donut where we see the blobs. And that's pretty much all we tend to see. That makes studying it much, much easier. So let me just very, very quickly tell you how we measure the strength. So what do I mean by strong? Well, something like strong, where you can clearly see something here, versus weak, where you have a lot of trouble seeing it. That's what I mean by the strength of the hallucination. So we designed a stimulus like this, where we would have the flickering ring, just like I showed you before, but without any blobs in there. So we want people to hallucinate the blobs in the outer ring. But in this inside ring here, we're going to have these black and white patterns. And we show people this stimulus, and all they have to do is tell us in which ring is the pattern stronger. That's it. They have to tell us one of the rings. They can't say, I don't know, or they can't say they look the same. We force them to make a choice, the large ring or the small ring. Which is stronger? Right? Strong, medium, very, very weak. Then we get a whole lot of data from participants here at the university, and we can do something that's called fitting a psychometric function. But what that lets us do is map out a point of equivalence. Right? So we're trying to find a point in which people are equally likely to say that that inner ring is about the same as the outer ring. And when we do that, we can figure out roughly what strength people are seeing the hallucination at. Okay? So this is a technique to measure the strength of this visual hallucination. This is a technique to measure the effective contrast, right? The dark versus the light of those blobs, rather than people just describing it or drawing it. And here's some data from the paper where we're showing the faster we flicker that donut, we get a function like this, where medium flicker rates around, say, 10, 11, 12 hertz, people are seeing stronger hallucinations. Once we get to faster flicker rates up here at 20, 30 hertz, the strength of the hallucination goes down. Another thing we did is develop a technique to measure the speed, the motion, how the hallucination moved. And to do that, we added these little green bars at the top and the bottom of the flickering donut shape. And what these do, they're markers to show our participants, our subjects, where they have to start tracking the movement of the hallucination. So it's a very simple experiment. Again, all our participants are doing is tracking the hallucination as it moves around that ring. They hit the space bar on a keyboard. When a certain portion of the hallucination passes, let's say the top line, and they watch it until it reaches the bottom green line, then they let go of the space bar. So we time how long it takes the hallucination to do half a rotation. And that gives us a time estimate for how long it takes to do half a revolution. And we also know the size of the stimulus. So we can quite easily figure out the speed. Another question we were interested in is, where is this hallucination happening in the brain? Is it happening in the eyes? Is it simply some kind of ocular distortion or something along those lines? Or is it a cortical experience, a cortical phenomenon? So we designed a tricky behavioral experiment. We didn't put people into the brain scanner for this. We designed a behavioral experiment in which we flickered two little rings, two little donut stimuli, one to one eye and the other to the other eye. And when we flicker them in synchrony like this, at a slow rate, people don't really see much hallucination. They see a weak hallucination. Then what we can do, here's the trick, we flicker them out of synchrony. So the one in one eye is on while the other one's off, then on, back and forward like that. So that's out of phase or out of synchrony. And here's the idea, when we flicker that at a very slow rate and they're in sync going together, all the brain is getting that slow flicker. When they're out of phase, neurons in the brain that are receiving information from both eyes are getting double that frequency, almost around double that frequency. So rather than this, they're actually seeing twice that, around, in this case, 5 hertz. So if people experience stronger hallucinations in this out of synchrony condition, that's good evidence that the hallucination is occurring in the brain and not in the eyes. And here I'm showing you the contrast, the effective contrast. That's just our way of measuring the hallucination like I talked about before. And here we have the synchronous condition. We have about a 20% contrast, effective contrast measure. Not that strong. And then we have the asynchronous condition. We're seeing a stronger, almost 30% contrast. And that's a significant difference. So people are experiencing the hallucination stronger in the out of phase, in the out of synchrony condition, which is good evidence that the hallucination is occurring in visual cortex, not in the eyes, or not in the back of the eyes, or anything like that. Another thing we've played around with is the ambiguity or the bistability of these hallucinations. So if you had took time, or you could see the hallucination on one of the other videos, you may have noticed that the blobs, once they appear, they rotate. And we talked about measuring the speed of rotation. Here, we're looking at the direction of rotation. And we found that if you look at it for a little while, the direction might be clockwise, then it might flip and be counterclockwise. So we got people to track these directions, and we found that people get about 50-50, about equal amounts of clockwise and counterclockwise motion directions. And that's kind of interesting for various reasons. That suggests that the systems in the brain that are processing this stimulus are what's called bistable. And there's hundreds of papers looking at bistability in neural systems and bistability in the visual cortex and bistability in visual perception. Another thing we want to look at is adaptation. Adaptation is a phenomenon that's general across all neural systems and across all perceptual systems. So what are we going to do here? We're going to show people a small ring, and we're going to have people tracking those alternations for a few minutes. Then we straight away show them a large ring, and they keep on tracking those alternations. So here's some data. We're showing the alternation duration, and then we have time on this axis. And we can see the durations are increasing, so the alternations in the direction of the hallucination are slowing down over time. So this is showing us that we see adaptation in this hallucination, just like visual perception. So that's interesting because it tells us that the hallucinated content, the flicker-induced hallucinations, obey the same basic principles as normal visual perception. So it gets more interesting. Then when we show the large ring that's non-overlapping with that small ring, it doesn't just keep on going. We actually see a resetting effect. The dominance durations slow down again, but continue adaptation. So what does this tell us? Well, it suggests that different neurons in the brain are processing the small and the large rings. So in other words, they're being processed locally in visual space. And again, that's another interesting clue to where this is being processed in the brain. It suggests, again, parts of the brain which care about visual space, that maintain the layout of the way the light hits our eyes. And that's called retinotopic. And it's based on the retinas out the back of our eyes, how the light hits them in this spatial layout. We don't have to rely on drawings or verbal descriptions anymore. We can do what people call psychophysics, standard behavioral psychophysics, on hallucinations. We can reduce that feature space from all these different shapes and colors down to simple blobs, and that opens the door to all this new types of research, all these new techniques. So we've been doing that here in normal subjects, here in the lab. We can test these kinds of flicker-induced hallucinations in anyone. I can do it. I can test it on you. What we're doing next is taking that out of the lab into the neurological clinic and looking at how patients might experience these flicker-induced hallucinations. And that's the next step in seeing if we can use this as a tool, a lab-based tool or a model to study pathological or clinical hallucinations. What mental health research needs is more translation from the lab into the clinic. And that's exactly what we're trying to do with this study. This is the first stage where we're just showing the basic technique, how we can reliably, objectively measure hallucinations in anyone, anytime, here in the lab. One way to think about this is a lab-based model of visual hallucinations. Just like people when they're studying cancer would have an animal model. They test things on animals before they go and test them on humans. I'm not talking about doing this in an animal model. I'm talking about a lab-based model where we can test the mechanisms, test the underlying reasons why hallucinations occur here in the lab. We can study it here anytime we want, figure out what's going on, then apply those findings to help people, apply them to new treatments. While some of this may seem a little different to how things have been done in the past, I think we need to start thinking a little bit differently about mental health and neurological treatments. We can't simply rely on old techniques to measure aspects of the mind. We really need to innovate new directions, new tests to measure the mind, new things that just won't look like the traditional ways. I'm a big fan of using illusions in this way. I'm a big fan of hacking illusions to develop a test to measure the mind. And you guys probably know that already, but these tests, they won't look like the old tests. They won't look like a pen and paper. They won't look like a questionnaire. It even freaks people out sometimes when I call it a test to measure the mind, because they're looking at an illusion. They're looking at shapes or colors on a computer monitor. But it's the direction we need to go in. We've come so far measuring the brain, measuring the physical components of the brain, the neurons, the anatomy of the brain, the molecular parts of the brain. But what we're really falling behind on drastically is measuring the mind, the experiences we have internally, the psychology of the mind. We need to bring psychology way into the future. We need to innovate drastically. We need to hack away and try different things. Try building tests using new technologies. These things won't look like the tests we've had in the past, and that's okay. That's great. That's exactly what we want. So I hope this video was interesting. I hope you got a little flavor of what we did in this study and why it could be useful or interesting.